When you browse the web, you're not really browsing the web, you're fetching bits of it and looking at it locally, right? So you're sending out to a server, server's sending you some data, you're viewing it on your screen in your browser. You click on something, it sends another request to some server, either the same one or a different one, pulls some more data down, you look at that on your screen. And so you've got to have a process for how you send that request and then how you get the responses sent back to you. So let's say you were to say this is your web browser, and then that's sitting above kind of a bunch of libraries. And so what's going to happen is you've got some data that starts out in your browser, so that's the request. And then that's going to get sent down through these libraries, eventually into the operating system. And what's going to happen there is that this chunk, which is your original data, maybe is going to get encoded as a TCP segment, one of the basic protocols that's used for supporting the World Wide Web. So on the front of that, it's going to stick some TCP information. And then a short while later, normally what will happen is all of that is just now thought of as data, and then you'll get some IP information on the front of it. And then a short while later, all of that will be thought of as data, and then you'll get some Ethernet information on the front, and maybe a little bit on the end as well. And again, for different particular versions of IP, so IPsec, you can end up with some information getting stuck on the end. So you've clicked on something, and that's got turned into a piece of data. The user wants to get to this particular URL.
Yeah.
Then that has to go down through a bunch of libraries. So I sort of missed out a step here, but that thing there, which might just be the URL, might have to get turned into something here, which is going to be a GET on that URL. This is the HTTP protocol. Okay, so it's turned that into this sort of more valid piece of HTTP. And then that is going to get treated just as a chunk of data. So it doesn't matter what's in there. It could be a URL, could be an image, could be anything you want. This is where the notion of a networking stack or a protocol stack comes from, is you've got all these things stacked up. Each of these different layers provides a different set of abstractions. It sort of builds on the abstractions provided by whatever's below it, and it provides some abstraction of the thing above it. For example, if you look at an Ethernet header, now I'm not going to try and draw all this out by memory because I will get it wrong. Essentially, you've got a sequence of stuff on there. So you start out with the destination address, then you have a source address, and then depending on precisely the version of Ethernet you're running, you have some information about the protocol of what's coming next. And then you might have some other header information, or you might just get the data. This destination address and source address will be 6 bytes each. I think it's 2 bytes there, normally. And then if you look inside what's happening at this layer, so it's that stuff there is the data that was put in the Ethernet frame. So let's say this protocol here indicates that it is actually an IP packet that's coming next. And in the IP header, you'll have things like there's a version, there's a length, the source address, the destination address, and then some other information that IP needs to operate the way IP does. So this is then the IP header. And then eventually you get to the data that you're transmitting. And the data you're transmitting in this case would start with a TCP header. Not even trying to get this in the right order now, but you've got, you know, a source port, you'll have a destination port, and some other things that TCP needs to do the things TCP does. Each of these layers is providing different features to the layer above. So in the case of Ethernet, for example, it provides this functionality for going from one machine to another machine. So the addresses it uses are the MAC addresses, the hardware addresses on your Ethernet card. So these are the machine addresses. It's a little bit more fuzzy now with wireless cards, because a lot of the time you can actually set the MAC address from software in some of those, and that can make things more complex and opens up all kinds of security holes and other possibilities, for example. But basically, yes, they should be uniquely identifying that particular network card. So it's a 6 bytes. They should be uniquely generated by the manufacturer of the card. So normally speaking, you split them into the first 3 bytes, which indicates which manufacturer it was. So whether it's, you know, Apple or Dell or IBM or someone. And then the other 3 bytes, which is just a counter that that manufacturer will assign in some way. All that Ethernet really is concerned with is getting that data from the guy who's transmitting it to somebody else connected to the same network, like immediately. So getting it to an immediate neighbor. So Ethernet is not concerned with the internet as a whole. It's not concerned with getting something to Google servers or something. It's just concerned with getting it to the next computer, a sort of next door computer of some kind. IP on top of that then says, okay, well, the abstraction that's going to provide is the idea that we've got, in the case of IPv4, we've got a bunch of computers that are all interconnected, they can all see each other, and we can now get data to move between networks. So if the computer you want to talk to is not immediately adjacent to you, IP kind of handles that. And there's a set of protocols that let IP do that by, for example, figuring out that actually, if you want to get to this guy, we don't know where he is right now, but what we can do is we can send it to a router that might be a bit close to the destination. And so you have this idea that when you started out up here and you were trying to get to google.com, as a bunch of other translations happen, and ultimately that comes down to the Ethernet layer, which effectively ends up saying, well, I don't know how to get to google.com, but I know how to get to your home router. And your home router might know how to get to google.com, so I'll send it there first. So that receives this Ethernet frame. Then your home router has to take off the Ethernet bits, look at the IP bits, and go, okay, where's this trying to get to? What should I do with it? And typically your home router is going to say, well, I don't know how to get to google.com either. In fact, at that point, it's not google.com, it's just an address. I don't know how to get to, you know, some string of numbers. But I do know that this router upstream from me and your ISP's network, your internet provider's network, that might have a better idea. So I'll send it there. And then that router is going to pick it up. And it'll get sent there using some means. So it might get sent there through Ethernet, but more likely it'll get sent there, you know, over the DSL line that you've got, or the cable modem or something. And that's a different set of standards again to Ethernet. So it doesn't have to be Ethernet down there. It can be something else. And that's going to get to the router in your internet provider's network. It's going to take off those bits that aren't interesting anymore. And it's going to look at the IP bits and go, okay, well, again, I don't know how to get to google.com exactly. I don't know where that is exactly. But this other router in your internet provider's network is closer to it. So I'll send it there. And it's this sort of continual putting it inside an envelope, passing it on. The guy takes the next router, takes it out of the envelope, looks at it and goes, ah, that direction. And it's that sequence of things which is what causes IP to be called a hop-by-hop network or a store-and-forward network. So you've got this, each router is kind of storing the packet for a little bit, looking at it, thinking about it, sending it on to the next place.
We'd like to thank Audible.com for supporting this video. And if you like your books as zeros and ones and what Computerphile doesn't, why not download a free audiobook at audible.com/computerphile? I'd recommend Outliers by Malcolm Gladwell, but my taste isn't always the best, so I asked Sean, who also works on Computerphile, and he recommended the books by Neil Stevenson. Bit of an epic series, he thinks very highly of it, so why not check them out? audible.com/computerphile, you can download a free audiobook, and this is an offer for people in the US and Canada at the moment. Thanks to them for supporting our videos, and thank you for watching. We'll be back soon.